Hey, open your Bible to the book of Hebrews, chapter 11. This morning we're going to talk about faith that moves mountains. Hebrews chapter 11. Welcome again to our Bring Your Neighbor Day service. We're going to have a spiritual meal right now in the scriptures.
Come on, bro.
We have a send-off prayer for our brother and sister, Taya and Gerald. And then we will prepare to have a feast together. But let's have a feast in the scriptures first, shall we?
Yeah.
Let's eat.
Faith that moves mountains. Well, first of all, what is faith and where do I get it? Anybody here watch the World Cup?
Yeah.
It's like the most important international thing happening right now. And people put their faith in their soccer team. Some people are very serious about their soccer team. Some countries are deadly serious about their soccer team. And they go into those matches with all this sense of pride and sense of country. And it's intense. Right? It's intense. Germany won in Sweden the other day, right? It was close, wasn't it? It was one of those nail biters.
2-1.
That one dude bent that last goal. I was like, wow. If you're not into football, wait, no, soccer, excuse me. If you're not into soccer, then they're like, what is this guy talking about? Understand this. We all can relate to putting our faith in a team, right?
Yeah.
Some of us grew up Charger fans, some of us grew up, Diamondbacks fans, some of us, we all have our team and some of us don't really care about sports, and that's okay. The Bible will talk to you this morning, amen? But I think, what is faith? We understand that in the sense of the team. I believe my team's going to win. I believe my quarterback or my striker, what have you. But what is faith according to God?
Right.
In Hebrews 11, verse 1. Now, faith is being sure what we hope for and certain what we do not see.
Amen.
Some people say that seeing is believing, right?
And
that's not what the Bible teaches. Now, your Bible does not say seeing is believing. It's in fact quite the opposite. Faith is being sure of something you don't see. Because you don't see God necessarily. Walk out and see God in his flowing robes out in the parking lot. You hear the angels. That's not what's happening. I mean, you look at Camelback Mountain and you feel that sublime sense of God's majesty. But you don't necessarily see him. You might see him work in your life, but you don't necessarily see him. The Bible says, though, faith is being sure of what you hope for and certain of what you do not see. This is what the angels were commended for. By faith, we understand the universe is formed at God's command, so that what is seen is not made out of what was visible. The universe, not the planets, not the planet, the universe. Billions and billions and billions and billions of stars. That's the universe. Space and distance unfathomable to the human mind. God made that. The fascinating aspects of the human mind, neurochemistry, psychobiology, God made that. The mysteries that we still don't understand about our oceans and the creatures and things in it, God made them. Light, photons, gluons, all that stuff. God's invention. Sometimes people think science, right, explains everything. Right? But you don't put your faith in an explanation. Just because science can describe something doesn't mean it explains it away. Right? Just because we figured something out doesn't mean we figured God out. We just unraveled more of his mysteries. The creator of this universe. By faith, we understand that the universe was formed at God's command, so that what is seen was not made out of what was visible. By faith, Abel offered God a better sacrifice than Cain did. By faith, he was commended as a righteous man when God spoke well of his offerings, and by faith, he still speaks even though he's dead. Now, if you don't know who Abel is, that's okay. You're still going to be able to understand the passage. Abel was commended for his faith because he made a sacrificial offering. Back in Genesis 4 is where you can look at it. But he made a very sacrificial offering. Gave his best to God in an act of worship. And I want to lift up the church. Because the church here in Phoenix has done something it's never done before. The Church of Phoenix has never given a six-figure sacrifice to missions. says it's a righteous faith, and it speaks through your offering loud and clear. $107,000, $400,000. That's over $10,000, $12,000 more than you've ever given.
Wow.
You're going to be commended for that. God's answering our prayer that our ministry become more mature and more able to sacrifice. Amen.
Yeah.
Come on, love.
The faith comes. As faith here is talking about more by about this guy named Enoch. Look at verse 5 with me. By faith, Enoch was taken from this life so that he did not experience death. He could not be found because God had taken him away. For before he was taken, he was commended as one who pleased God. And without faith, it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. If you're visiting Green Neighbor Day today, you've taken your first step in seeking after God. Maybe you've taken a few before this, but today, for sure, you're taking a step towards seeking after God. God rewards those who earnestly seek Him. Not sort of seek Him, right? Now, when I was going to college, if anybody said free food, I'd be, you know what I'm saying? Right? Free food? Really? Let me just confess some sin right here, okay? Will there be girls? Hey, man, let me just... We got to keep it real here as a family. That's the truth.
Come on, bro.
Okay? Sorry for making college guys uncomfortable. I can relate to that. Amen. That's where I come from. When I get invited to church, the person certainly was sure, but they did not see her and hope for, because I was hungover and out of my right mind when I got invited to church. I had this tie-dye shirt on. My hair was all hippied out like this. You know, I was an art student at the University of Hawaii. Got my cutoffs on, my slippers, bloodshot eyes, skipping class because I could not think straight. And I told myself, while in this haze, maybe I should go to church, because I'm going to mess my college career up. I'm messing my friendships up. That one night stand I had last night is messing my conscience up. Maybe I should just go to church, find a church group.
Go on, Jeremy.
That's where I was at.
Yeah.
While I was thinking about it, somebody invited me. About freaked me out. Seriously. They already was kind of hippie, but that was like, no way, dude. And I couldn't say like a sentence without cursing. Like, seriously, the poor guy, you know. They invited me to church. He thought I was homeless, so he gave me the church office number. Why? Well, sometimes we get a position in our life we just don't think we can change. Or we try to change and we fail, and so we stop trying.
Yes.
We just settle down and settle.
Wow.
For what we can see. Amen?
Amen.
What is faith? Now, that's what faith is according to the scriptures. It's being sure what you hope for and certain what you don't see. Well, how do I get it? Look with me in Romans chapter 10.
Okay.
How do I get faith? I want some faith. How do I get it? I mean, this is not a milk commercial. Got faith. Do you have cookies with that or what? How do we get it? Romans 10, verse 17. Consequently, faith comes from hearing the message, and the message is heard through the word of Christ. So if you want faith, then God can get in your Bible. Wait, you understand, man, I grew up reading the Bible. I know, obviously, you used to have some faith, but now that you've stopped reading the Bible, you don't have much anymore. But I know what it says. I know you know what it says. You have an idea of what it says. I don't know about you, but there's like 1,000 pages in this thing, and I forget a lot more than I remember. And I've had this for 25 years, so I know I'm supposed to remember more stuff, and sometimes I do, but let me tell you something. Every day, when I commit to listening to God and reading the message from the Word of Christ, if I decide to do that, it builds my faith.
Come on, bro.
That's where you get faith.
Yeah.
Maybe you're like, man, I don't know about this church thing. I don't know. You don't know because you're not pursuing faith.
Mm-hmm.
If you just decided today, I'm going to start reading my Bible every day, and I'm going to study my Bible, you'll get some faith.
Yeah.
Faith that can move a mountain. Faith that can change anything. Faith that can transform. Faith that can change a landscape enough to lift a mountain and dump it into the sea.
Come on.
But you got to read your Bible every day.
Yeah.
Don't make an excuse that you grew up in a religious environment and think that's like, check, read the Bible. No.
Right.
The scriptures aren't like meant to be read once and then you put it on the shelf for it to collect dust. The scriptures are designed for you to have a dynamic, engaging relationship with God. Yeah. Amen? So you get faith by hearing the message. Well, okay. Well, how do I hear the message? Well, scoot back with me here in Romans 10. Look at verse 14. The Bible asks some questions here. It says, how then can they call on the one they've not believed in? And how can they believe in the one of whom they've not heard? And how can they hear without someone preaching to them? And how can they preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news. We have to send them. People have to be sent to preach and call others to go after the message. People need to hear the message preached. If you wonder what a six-figure missions offering goes to, it's that.
Yeah.
It's not for me. I drive a Kia, and most of y'all know where I live, so you know what I'm saying? But God has blessed our churches amazingly since 2007.
Yeah.
42 brothers and sisters from the Portland Church moved out to Los Angeles. That's crazy in and of itself, moving to Los Angeles, amen? Right? I'm not dissing LA, I'm just speaking the truth in love here, okay? And in the span of the last 11 years, God has multiplied that into over 6,000 sold-out disciples, 91 churches, 36 nations, and 6 continents, amen? Why? We raised missions so we could send people on the missions and live out the missions. Amen?
Amen.
And that's what's going on. We're sending people to Columbus, Ohio.
Yeah.
We got a supporter to send there. Amen? We're sending some people to Milwaukee, Wisconsin.
That's what
we're sending. We just sent some people to New Delhi, India. Right? We got to support the Chennai World in India. We got to support the Lagos. It was inspiring when we watched the thank you video. And Andrew Patrick Smelly from Lagos thanked us for our missions offering. And then now, like, you know, on the Facebook thing, the popular Facebook, there's a page for the Lagos church, and they post all the people's lives that are being impacted. And I'm like, this is incredible. It's because people are being sacrificed.
Awesome.
That's why that happens. People are sent, they hear the message, and the message is heard, and people's lives change. I mean, wasn't it amazing to hear about how Chelsea's life transformed?
Yeah.
Everybody in this room has a story like that. And if it hasn't been written yet, it will be written by your faith. Amen?
Amen.
Come on.
So what makes faith alive? Because you can have a dead faith. I don't know if you knew that. You know, you can have a car and it can be a lemon and it can be dead. No fun, right? Look at James chapter 2.
Bro.
Where's faith? Where do I get it? Faith is being sure what you hope for, certain what you don't see. You get it through hearing the message. We've got to get into the Bible and really study it out. James chapter 2. What makes faith a lie? James chapter 2. Verse 14. What good is it, my brothers, if a man claims to have faith but has no deeds? Can such a faith save him? Okay, what's the answer to that? So if you have faith, but no deeds with it, can that faith save you? Not according to this. I mean, that's the point of the rhetorical question, right? And then he makes a comparison, verse 15. Suppose a brother or sister is without clothes and daily food. If one of you says to him, go, I wish you well, keep warm and well fed, but does nothing about his physical needs, what good is that? Is that good at all? Imagine if I walked up to my brother Sean and he's like, bro, I haven't eaten in a couple of days. I could use a hamburger right now or something. Can we make a sandwich? Bro, I just need to eat. And I'm like, you know, bro, Sean, you're awesome. Dude, I wish you warm. Keep warm. Keep well fed too, bro. See you. Why would the brother be dissing me like that? I don't feel the love. Does that help anybody?
No.
In the same way, our faith doesn't have action accompanied with it. It's just as useless.
Yeah.
You see, that shows a relationship that you just don't care about.
Yeah.
I really care about somebody, then I'm going to help. I'm going to give them some food or some clothing or what they need. Right? And the same way, if you really care about your faith, you're going to do something with it. Amen?
Yeah.
The Bible says in verse 17, just clarifying this, in the same way, faith by itself, if not accompanied by action, is dead. Whew. So that means you can have a faith. You can believe in God, and still, it's dead. What? Now, I grew up in an environment where I heard this before. All you got to do is just believe. All you got to just believe. Like, wait a minute, how do I make that work with this passage? Especially the next one we're going to read. Let's keep reading.
Come on.
Show me faith without deeds, and I show you my faith by what I do. You believe there's one God? Good. Even the demons believe that and shudder.
Wow.
Wait, so if belief is enough, then the demons are saved, right? Because they believe, right? So the demons believe that they're all right. No, of course not. Why? Because the demons don't do what's right. That's why they're demons.
Yeah.
They have faith, but they don't obey it. They don't submit to it. They don't act on it.
Wow.
They believe. They know God is there. They fear and they shudder. God's, but they don't do what's right. They don't act on it.
Yeah.
I mean, what good is coming out to church if you're not going to make any changes? I mean, this isn't fast food. This isn't chicken. Just trying to butter your biscuits. That's all. I want to get you to think. You need to think about your faith and your deeds today. You did not come here today for a religious experience. God brought you here to transform you, to inspire you, to call your faith to greater places, to shine the light in you, to change you, to prepare you for what tomorrow is going to bring, and the day after that, and the rest of your life. God brought you here to make you alive, transform you. Let's keep reading. Verse 20. You foolish man, you want evidence of faith without deeds is useless. What are you really carrying on about this, isn't it? Like, the Bible's not letting this go. It's like, it wasn't enough to say the demons believe and they shudder and that's it. No, he's like, I keep going on this. This obviously is really important, isn't it?
Yeah.
You foolish man, you want evidence of faith without deeds is useless. Was our ancestor Abraham considered righteous for what he did when he offered his son Isaac on the altar? You see that his faith and his actions were working together. And his faith was made complete by what he did. And the scripture was fulfilled that says, Abraham believed God, and it was credited him by righteousness. Credited him as righteousness. And he was called God's friend. You see that a person is justified by what he does, and not by faith alone. In the same way, was not even Rahab, what? The what? The Bible said that? Yeah, prostitute. Rahab the prostitute. More than that, she's a pagan, like non-Jew prostitute. Wow. So was not even Rahab the prostitute considered righteous for what she did when she gave lodging to the spies and sent them off in a different direction? As the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without deeds is dead. Wow. What makes faith alive? What you do.
Yeah.
Look at me in Matthew chapter 1.
Alright.
You ever read a part of the Bible that you just kind of want to charm the ground? You know what I'm talking about? Some of y'all may haven't seen the Peanuts cartoons, so you don't know what I'm talking about. But let me give you an example. You ready? Matthew chapter 1, verse 1. A record of the genealogy of Jesus, Christ the Son of David, the son of Abraham. Abraham was a father. And Zerah the mother is Play verse 4. Ram the father of Amminadab, Amminadab the father of Nashon, Nashon the father of Salmon, Salmon the father of Boaz, whose mother was. Well, now it just got interesting, didn't it?
Yeah.
Whose genealogy is this? This is the genealogy of Jesus Christ. Lord and Savior, King of Kings, our Messiah. This is his genealogy. His great, 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 great grandmother was a pagan prostitute. What's special about her? It wasn't her sin that defined her. It was What's going to define you today? Is it going to be the sin that you're in, or the faith that begins? What's going to define you? What is your legacy going to be? Is it going to be one of transformation and faithfulness? Or is your legacy going to be one of, well, you know, I'm just not into the, I don't know. We say I don't know because we don't want to go. Because we say, well, I'm not sure. No, the Bible's really clear on the actions we need to take to follow God. Super, super clear.
Right.
Promise, it's clear. You study the Bible with whoever brought you out,
yeah,
you'll find out, man, the Bible's really clear, man.
Yeah.
It's not ambiguous.
Yeah.
Right. It calls us all to make radical changes for our own good. Mm-hmm. Sometimes we say, I don't know, because we don't want to go.
Yeah.
We just need to admit, it's time to have a little faith. Faith is being sure what you hope for, right? Sometimes we're like, I don't know if this is going to work out for me. Right? I can't see the next step. Well, faith is taking it anyway.
Yeah.
That's why they call it the leap of faith. If you're not sure where you're going to land, you're just jumping, amen?
Come on, bro.
Some of us need to jump. And make sure our faith is brought to life. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 6.
Okay.
You saw the legacy of Rahab? She's not alone in the transformation from faith. 1 Corinthians chapter 6. Not inherit the kingdom of God. Do not be deceived. Neither the sexually immoral, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor male prostitutes, nor homosexual offenders, nor thieves, nor the greedy, nor drunkards, nor slanderers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. Now, if you stop there, that is discouraging. But don't stop. Don't look at your faults and stop there.
Mm-hmm.
You got to look at the Word of God and God and have faith. He looked at a pagan prostitute and saw a woman who could repent and be faithful. What does he see when he looks at you today?
Wow.
Come on, bro.
Maybe this is some of these things are in your life. I mean, I'm like, check, check, check. Immorality, impurity, pornography, drunkenness. I mean, that's my life before I studied the Bible.
Yeah.
Come on.
And if you ask me, dude, are you a Christian? I would say, yeah, I'm a Christian. Mm-hmm. Well, what about that marijuana you're smoking? Well, you know, I slip sometimes.
Keep it real, bro.
What about that, you know, didn't you get drunk last week? Aren't you sleeping around with your girlfriend? Well, you know, me and God, we have an understanding.
Mm-hmm.
We're good, you know. I just messed up once last, but forgiveness is good. I mean, imagine if you spit in your wife's face and just expected her to accept it.
Wow.
Why do we think it will spit in God's face and think he'll accept it?
Yeah.
Rahab didn't do that. She realized where she was at, and her faith transformed her.
Yeah.
And her legacy became that she was the great, great, great grandmother of our Lord and Savior.
Wow.
If you let faith transform you, it's only in God's hands.
Mm-hmm.
Imagine what your legacy will be.
Yeah.
Much, much greater than anything you can fathom. God will use you in ways you couldn't even possibly understand. But you gotta have faith.
Come on,
Jack. Come on, bro.
Verse 11. And that is what some of you were. You see, he's addressing. He's addressing the congregation and saying, some of you came from this background.
Yeah.
But what? That's what some of you were. But what? You were washed. You were sanctified. You were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God. They were transformed. And just like Rahab, they had a destiny that was astonishing. Amen?
Come on, bro. Come on.
You left one of these fire. That's great. Two of you, man. John chapter 8. Third point. What makes faith count? It really bothers people when they do something that doesn't count, right? How many here went to college?
Went to college.
You're not in college. last semester. Does that count?
Yes, that counts.
You ever had an online teacher when it really expects you to, like, toe the line?
Yeah. I had more than one of those, but I had one of those in,
and I remember turning in a paper late. You ever done that?
Yeah.
I try to put on the snooze, maybe look on the puppy dog eyes a little bit. But my job and my church and my this and my schedule and can I turn it in late? I really appreciate the teachers that said to me, no. Doesn't count. But I did all the work! Yeah, but it's 2 days late, man. Doesn't count.
Right.
But.
Come on.
That is not graduate college, by the way. But. You're not going to graduate college saying that.
Wow.
No butts, no cuts, no coconuts. It doesn't count. We just learned that faith can be dead without action, right? Well, let's figure out what makes faith count. Because I don't know about you, I want a faith that's alive and a faith that counts. Amen?
Yeah.
Look at me on verse 30.
Come on, bro.
Now, we established earlier that faith comes from hearing the message. And the message is heard through the word of Christ, right? So can you imagine if you heard Jesus preaching? Would you have some faith if you heard Jesus preaching?
Yeah.
I mean, that'd be pretty awesome. The word itself, preaching the word to you, that'd be fired up. Well, that makes sense. If you look at John 8, verse 30. The Bible says, even as Jesus spoke, many put their faith in him. So Jesus had a crowd of people, who's the Jewish Bigger Neighbor Day or something, I don't know, and he's preaching, and they put their faith in him. Like, yep, amen, Jesus, that's right. Many people were like fired up and believed in Jesus. Because they heard Jesus preaching Jesus. Amen? Okay, so what he's about to say in this next passage, in verse 31, he's addressing the people that actually put their faith in him. The people that didn't put their faith in him, he's not addressing. He's not talking to them. He's like, look, if you believe in me, boom, let me talk to you. If you don't believe in me, I'm not talking to you because you don't believe in me. What's the point, right? Because faith, by definition, to stay alive, should call you to action.
Yeah.
And if you have some faith, then God, then Jesus, then the Word of God can call you to action.
Yeah.
And right here, Jesus says to the Jews who had believed him, if you hold my teaching, you are really my disciples, then you know the truth, and the truth will set you free.
Amen.
Amen.
So,
if it's going to count, my faith, then I got to do what? Hold to Jesus' teachings. Maybe you think to yourself, well, you know, I'm familiar with Jesus' teachings. I hold to them. I want to challenge you with that.
Come on, bro.
I grew up going to church, and I grew up telling myself everything was okay, and I heard it enough until I started believing it and drowning the guilt in my life with religious experience. And that's not the same as a relationship with God. A relationship with God will transform you from the inside out.
Yeah.
It'll strip away bitterness. It'll strip away pride. It'll strip away resentment. It'll strip away the things that mar and taint the soul.
Yeah.
It'll transform you. And I remember when I first studied the Bible and someone confronted me with the scriptures that Jesus taught about being his disciple. Then I got to deny myself, pick up my cross every day and follow Jesus. And I remember talking to the guys and asking them, what exactly does that mean? I mean, do I got to go buy some cross jewelry, you know, or something, or what? Like, no. The cross symbolizes dying to yourself every day. Like, wait a minute. I thought this Christian thing was going to make my life easier. What do you mean, pick up my cross and die to myself every day? That does not sound easier to me. The point isn't doing what's easy. The point is doing what's right.
Yeah.
And if we're going to do what's right, then we're going to be different men and women after today.
Yeah.
Because we decided to get a faith that moved mountains. And maybe the mountain that you feel like you got to move is your own character. Or the own pile of dirt that got in your life. I mean, I don't know. I'm going to move. Just faith will move it. Come on. God moved it for a prostitute. She transformed. She became into the lineage of Jesus.
Yeah.
What can God do with you if you just haven't lived? Would transform what nations are on the horizon for you. I never thought I'd be a preacher. In fact, there's a friend of mine I used to sin with. We would go out, we'd drink, we'd steal, we were hooligans, to my shame. And we're good friends. And then my family had not seen him. We moved away. I moved from Hawaii to the mainland, etc. And I talked to him for years. But his memories of me being so wild and so enslaved, my impurity, my drunkenness, my drug use. My aunt met him in the shopping mall and said, "Oh, hey, you're so-and-so, Jeremy's friend from, you know." And he asked me about me. And she said, "Oh, he's a preacher now." She said the color drained out of his face and he sat down. I was like, "What?" Nobody believed I could change.
Wow.
You know why? Because I didn't believe I could change.
Wow.
And the minute I started believing I could change, the minute I just eclipsed the mustard seed of faith, man, God grew that and more and more and more, and I saw things change in my life I never thought would change. Wow. You know, I didn't meet my father. Ever. My biological father. Did not know him. There was a huge estrangement between him and my mom. It's a long story for another sermon. But here's the thing. I never thought I could have a relationship with him. But because of faith, and someone calling me to hold to the teachings of the Bible about forgiveness, yeah, about repentance, about really changing my heart and my mind. I met my father for the first time about 10 years ago.
Wow.
I celebrated my Christmas with him. First Christmas. And I remember the first thing we did is play CCR's Down on the Corner.
That's right.
Because I love music, and my dad's a musician and a singer and a bass player. This is so weird. Because I did that professionally for a while. I mean, that's so weird. Okay, I guess I got your DNA, dude. Down on the corner. That happened because of faith. Now I got to see him a couple days ago. He came through town. And I have a relationship with my physical father. Why? Faith. Why? Faith. Had nothing to do with me. I was stuck. I was discouraged. I didn't have hope. Faith is being sure what you hope for. I didn't see it happening. Sir, what you do not see. But I just let someone guide me with the word. Put some faith in me. And I just obeyed. Just put some action. Got on the internet. Made a couple calls. Boom. I'm hanging out with my dad.
Awesome.
More than that, I found out I had family, brothers and sisters I never even met before. And to God's glory, last year, my brand new brother I just met, who's, you know, a couple years younger than me, I got to do his wedding ceremony for him.
Wow.
What adventure is waiting for you if you just decide you're going to study the Bible and hold to Jesus' teaching? What wild ride is ahead of you because of your faith? If you just cut a little bit, God will do something amazing. You with me, guys?
Yeah.
What else makes faith count? Look at me in Galatians 5.
Come on, bro.
Galatians 5. I want faith to count. You want your faith to count?
Yes, bro.
I want my faith to be alive. You want your faith to be alive?
Yes, bro.
What makes faith count? Galatians chapter 5. Verse 6. For in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision has any value. The only thing that counts is faith expressing itself through love. That's it. How do you make your faith count? Express it in love. How do you do that? Well, first of all, we've got to talk about what love is a little bit, shouldn't we? And here's arguably one of the most famous scriptures in the Bible. But I want to ask you to think about it in terms of your faith. Look at me in 1 Corinthians 13.
All right, bro.
You guys still with me?
Yeah.
Come on, bro. 1 Corinthians 13. Give me an amen when you get there.
Amen.
1 Corinthians 13. Verse 1. If I speak in the tongues of men and angels, but have not love, I'm only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have a gift of prophecy and fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have a faith that can move mountains but have not love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and surrender my body to the flames but have not love, I gain nothing. You can have a faith that moves mountains, but if you don't have love, it doesn't count. And so then the question is, okay, how does faith and love connect it? Well, look at verse 4. Love is patient. What does it mean to be patient? That you're willing to suffer with someone through their stubbornness. It takes you to change. What does that take? Being sure what you're hoping for and certain what you're not seeing. Love is kind. What is kindness? Doing what you do not want to do when you do not want to do it. And you don't get anything in return. Kindness, you don't get anything. It's like not anybody paying you or buying you a cheeseburger, okay? You're just doing it out of kindness. Why? Because you're sure what you hope for.
Yeah.
And certainly you don't see. You don't see any reward, but you know you're going to get one. It is not envy. Now what's envy? Envy is looking at somebody else's situation and wanting that situation so much that you resent that person for having a better situation than you.
Yeah. Wow.
They got a new car. How come I didn't get a promotion to get a new car? They got a nice house. Look at my house. Looks like it needs a paint job. And our pool looks like a swamp. But look at my neighbor's house. If I didn't have this and that, and the other, we just get envious. It takes faith not to be envious. You envy me. Well, we need a bigger house. We need a better car. We need a better this thing. Listen, you don't need that stuff.
Yeah.
You've got to be sure of what you hope for and certain what you do not see. Don't worry about the challenges. Don't worry about your neighbor. Just focus on your relationship with God and be content with Him.
Mm-hmm.
And you won't envy. You see how faith ties into these?
Yeah.
It does not boast. It is not proud. It is not rude. It's not self-seeking. It's not easily angered. It takes faith not to be easily angered.
Mm-hmm.
How do you know? There you go again. You always do that. You always, you never. Those are very faithless statements. But when you have faith, you have hope and you believe people can change. And you don't keep a record of wrongs, right? You just keep no record of wrongs. Now what does that look like? I've been married for a while, just 18 years, so it's not too long. She doesn't look like she's been married 18 years, but I you know, I don't care and I age very well. And so, this business of keeping right and wrongs, what does that look like? We know enough, especially for church folk. Like, we know enough that we're supposed to say we're sorry. You with me on this?
Yeah.
But sometimes we say we're sorry, it's kind of mechanical, so we know we're supposed to do it. Or we put a button, yeah, I'm sorry. I'm sorry, but you shouldn't have spoken to me that way. I'm sorry, but when you raise your voice, it just makes me struggle. I'm sorry, but. What are you apologizing to? An excuse? We don't want to bury the hatchet with the handle sticking out. You know what I'm talking about? Bury the hatchet. What does that take? Faith that that person will eventually change. And so you don't bring up all their past failures and they fail the same way again and you don't get better at it. No, what you do is you have faith. God's going to work in the situation. They are going to change. You guys with me on this?
Come on, bro.
Let's close as we ask, where do we put our faith in? Colossians chapter 2. What do you put your faith in? Yourself? Put my faith in myself. Okay, well, what can you really do? You know, somebody can bench press 400 pounds, but what can you really do? Right? Some of you might be able to do some really cool equations or figure out organic chemistry. Some of you might be able to run a business or an infrastructure for an IT firm. Some of you might be able to throw down and fix some really good grub. But what can you really do compared to the creator of the universe?
Right.
You can't move a mountain. You might be able to climb it, but moving it?
Yeah.
Like 300 million pounds of rock? You can't do that. What can you do? But if you have faith in God and you believe in God, He will empower you to do things you never imagined.
Yeah.
He will empower you to transform in ways you never thought were possible.
Yeah.
He will give you courage to do and to say things that you never thought you could ever do or say.
Yeah.
He'll give you strength to raise your children. He'll give you wisdom to love your spouse. He'll give you insight. So you pick the right girl or the right guy. Are you with me on this? God can give you so much more. So we need to put our faith in God. Amen. Colossians chapter 2. We'll close here. Verse 11.
All right.
In Jesus, you were also circumcised in the putting off the sinful nature. Not with the circumcision done by the hands of men, but with the circumcision done by Christ. I know how to put this. Say what? Excuse me? He's making a comparison here, right? He's talking about a circumcision done by the hands of men and a circumcision done by who?
Christ.
Do you see in the scripture? Circumcision done by Christ? Well, that's interesting. So, that means that there's a circumcision that's done by the hands of men. Well, if you remember what we talked about earlier, that has to do with the Old Covenant and the Old Testament, and that was part of the rules of being part of the Old Covenant. That's something you had to do if you're going to be a part of the Abraham and all that stuff. But you had to do that. A physical circumcision. The Bible here is saying that this is not a physical circumcision. Because it's not done by people. It has nothing to do with that Old Covenant. This is a circumcision done by who?
Christ.
By Christ. Okay. In Him you also circumcised, verse 11 again, in the putting off of sinful nature. Not with a circumcision done by the hands of men, but the circumcision done by Christ, having been baptized, buried with them in baptism, and raised with them through your faith in the power of God who raised them from the dead. You need to put your faith in the power of God.
Yeah.
Why? Because it raised Jesus from the dead. I am still faithful to God today because Jesus Christ rose from the dead. That is the crux of the gospel. That is the truth. Jesus Christ rose from the dead. None of this makes any sense if that's not the case. There's no reason to repent, to transform, even to have faith if Jesus wasn't risen from the dead.
Yeah.
But it's through the power of God that He came out of that tomb. It's through the power of God that He came back in the flesh and had a piece of fish in front of Him, Luke 24, to prove it. It's a really interesting passage, read later. Right? And He appeared to hundreds of people. And He hung out for 40 days and all He did was talk about the kingdom.
Right.
You know, today, I want to urge you to put your faith in God.
Yeah.
And the power of God to transform you. The power of God to inform you. The power of God to change your destiny. I want to urge you to know who faith is and get some. You may have thrown up reading the Bible. I want to challenge you to get back to that. Amen? Uh-huh. And study the Bible whatever you came out with. Why? Because the transformation and the destiny is ahead of you.
Yeah.
Maybe think to yourself, well, I've heard this before. You know, I've been here before. Listen, with a little bit more faith, God will take you places you've never been.
Yeah.
You cannot tell me that they have expected to be in the genealogy of Jesus Christ.
Yep. Come on.
You just had a little bit of faith, and that's all you need. Just a little bit of faith.
Yeah.
Thank you, and God bless.